Hi there. If you want to learn all about ecstasy and its effects on the human body, it's not as safe as you think, then stay tuned. So, ecstasy. What's its pharmacology and what are its clinical effects? So, first of all, we need to understand how it's called. So, street names for ecstasy include Molly, X, XTC, E, beans, rolls. But the chemical name for ecstasy is 3,4-methylenedioxymethamphetamine, MDMA. So, firstly, we need to understand that it is a derivative of amphetamine. So, for thinking about molecules within this family, we have MDA, which is methylene deoxyamphetamine, which is an active metabolite of MDMA, which is methylene deoxymethamphetamine. We also have PMA, which is paramethoxyamphetamine, and this is highly toxic and it's an adulterant found in ecstasy. And then we have PMMA, which is paramethoxy-N-methylamphetamine, and again is more dangerous than MDMA ecstasy. So if we look at the structure of PMA and PMMA, we can see that PMA contains a paramethoxy group, but it lacks the methylene deoxy ring of MDMA. This means it's more toxic at lower doses. And if we look at the structure of PMMA, we can see the N-methylated version of PMA, and this is often sold as ecstasy. So the structures are similar, and it's important to realize that both of these molecules are related to MDMA, which itself is related to amphetamines. So talking specifically about the increased harms associated with PMA or PMMA, first of all, these drugs have a slower onset. So if you're waiting for the high, then you're probably going to take more or at least a repeated dose before you actually get an effect. And so therefore, you're going to expose yourself overall to higher doses. These drugs are also associated with higher levels of hyperthermia, which is a dangerous increase in temperature, up to, you know, even 43 degrees centigrade. You're going to have a higher risk of serotonin syndrome, which is serotonergic toxicity, and this occurs even at doses that are used for recreation. And overall, there's a high mortality, so the lethal dose is much closer to the recreational dose. So the bottom line is PMA and PMMA are much more toxic than MDMA. So let's look at the pharmacology. So it's both PMA and PMMA are potent monoamine oxidase inhibitors. So they inhibit serotonin metabolism, and this contributes to the risk of serotonin syndrome. Both of these substances increase serotonin release without having any dopamine release or norepinephrine or noradrenaline release. Both of these molecules disrupt temperature regulation, so we have already mentioned the hyperthermia, and then there's the delayed onset. So again, delayed onset leads to dangerous redosing. So let's look at ecstasy. So ecstasy is an atypical amphetamine-type stimulant. So it is amphetamine-like. MDMA, methylene deoxymethamphetamine, it is related to amphetamine. So it does have stimulant properties via dopamine, noradrenaline, norepinephrine. It does have other actions, and in particular, it increases serotonin and oxytocin effects to create a unique empathic state. It also is a mild hallucinogen because it causes activation of the serotonin 2A receptor, causing perceptual changes. And it does have triple monoamine release and reuptake inhibitors function. So by that, I'm talking about dopamine, noradrenaline, and serotonin. So if we look at the dosing of ecstasy, this typical dose is 75 to 125 milligrams for standard recreational use. Heavy use is associated with the use of over 200 milligrams. But at these doses, we are really risking toxicity, in particular the serotonergic toxicity, the hypothermia, and also some other side effects that we'll discuss in a moment. Now, ecstasy is more recently being investigated for the management of PTSD, and this is only in research settings, but in these settings, we're using very, very low doses. So, for instance, 1.5 milligrams per kilogram. And if we're thinking about recreational doses again, so really once you're going over 300 milligrams, then you really are crossing the severe toxicity risk threshold. So the way that we can consume ecstasy is in pressed tablets. So there's, unfortunately, there's variable content, often cut with adulterants. Then there are capsules sold as Molly, which is supposedly pure MDMA. And then there's crystal powders, which are insufflated or dissolved in liquid and then ingested. If we think about the kinetics of ecstasy, we've always got to think about absorption, first of all. And so ecstasy is rapidly absorbed in the gut. The time to peak effect is 60 to 90 minutes, which is quite fast. It's roughly equivalent to endone or diazepam. But the onset of effect actually begins within 30 to 45 minutes, and the duration lasts about 5 hours. The metabolism of ecstasy is interesting. The half-life is 8 to 9 hours after a 100 to 125 milligram dose. It's metabolized by the liver, predominantly by CYP2D6. And remember, CYP2D6 is 2% of the enzyme function of the entire cytochrome family, but metabolizes 20% of drugs. There's a secondary catechol-O-methyl transferase metabolic pathway that can also metabolize ecstasy. The metabolites are MDA, methylene deoxyamphetamine, HMMA, and HMA, which is inactive. And the excretion of ecstasy, well, it's 50% excreted unchanged in urine, and the rest is conjugated as glucuronides or sulfates. So what are the effects? Well, first of all, ecstasy is a stimulant. So we need to understand stimulation in terms of the cardiovascular system, the central nervous system, and the thermoregulatory nervous system. So cardiovascular effects include tachycardia, hypertension, and increased myocardial oxygen demand. Central nervous stimulant effects include agitation, seizures, and bruxism, jaw clenching. And thermoregulatory effects include hyperthermia and increased metabolic rate and muscle rigidity. Now, the empathogen effects. So ecstasy inhibits serotonin transport proteins, which block serotonin reuptake. Oxytocin release is also an effect of ecstasy. So this enhances social bonding. So overall, we get this empathic state with increased trust, empathy, and sensuality. But actually, there's a sexual paradox here because even though users of ecstasy seek emotional intimacy, there is actually erectile dysfunction and dysorgasmia. And if we look at the hallucinogen effects, these are all due to the serotonin 2A agonism. So ecstasy is a partial activator of serotonin 2A receptors. It's weaker than the other classical psychedelics. It does have perceptual effects, including enhanced color and texture appreciation and heightened sensory experiences. There are cognitive effects, so we've got altered thought patterns. We're making novel associations and we're enjoying emotional insights. And then there are visual effects, so we've got mild visual distortions, we've got pattern recognition enhancement, and we've got sometimes real hallucinations of the visual system, so visual hallucinations. So what about the therapeutic applications of ecstasy? So as I've already mentioned, it's being investigated as a treatment modality for PTSD. There are other neurobiological effects, so it reduces amygdala activity, it decreases the fear response. It can be used as a psychotherapy adjunct, so we can have 2 to 3 MDMA sessions with psychotherapy, which facilitates the processing of trauma. But again, this needs to be very protocolized, and it's currently a research tool only. Now, the side effects. So we've got physical side effects, autonomic side effects, and neurological side effects. So really, I've already kind of alluded to the bruxism, but also we can experience sweating, diaphoresis, and mydriasis, which is pupil dilatation. We get the autonomic instability with tachycardia, hyperthermia, and xerostomia, so dry mouth. And then we've got the neurological effects, including nystagmus, muscle tension, and paresthesias, so, you know, numbness and tingling. And then there's this thing called the ecstasy hangover. So because of serotonin depletion, After use, people are very prone to depression, fatigue, and irritability that can usually last 2 to 5 days. And then we have gender-specific side effects associated with ecstasy. So in males, we have greater MDMA-induced cortisol release. We have, therefore, higher blood pressure responses, more severe erectile dysfunction, and faster drug metabolism. In women, we have stronger subjective effects at doses that are equal to those given to men. We have more pronounced temperature elevation. We have greater mood enhancement and more severe neurotoxicity at higher doses. So we also need to consider hormonal influences and how that affects drug responses. So women may need lower doses to achieve the same effect, albeit an illicit effect. So other serious side effects include hyperthermia, so up to 43 degrees centigrade in core temperature, and hyponatremia. This is due to syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion and excessive water intake. Serotonin syndrome, characterized by hyperthermia, rigidity, and autonomic instability. Rhabdomyolysis, so muscle breakdown leading to renal failure. Hepatotoxicity, direct liver damage, and hyperthermia-mediated liver damage. Cardiovascular toxicity, so fatal or near-fatal arrhythmias and hypertensive crises or even stroke. And then disseminated intravascular coagulation. If we look at the psychiatric complications, we can experience acute anxiety, panic attacks during intoxication, major depression, so it can unmask major depression, and it can also, as I've said earlier, have this 2 to 5 day hangover effect where people feel very depressed. It can cause psychosis, drug-induced psychosis associated with visual disturbances. But it can also cause specific visual disturbances with preserved insight. And it can increase suicide risk. So we need to understand that ecstasy, whilst it may be seen as a less harmful drug than, for instance, methamphetamine, it is still an atypical stimulant. It still has stimulant side effects. In particular, it's associated with hyponatremia and hyperthermia. And hyponatremia is particularly an issue with women. And so, as a sobering conclusion, we need to acknowledge the risk of one pill death for young women, or for that matter, anyone, using ecstasy for the first time. That's all for today, folks. My name's Dr. Ferghal Armstrong, and this has been Cracking Addiction.